service?
Ty, I think he leaves in December.
Okay.
Yes.
I knew he was getting ready to.
Right, grandson.
Desmond, you have something? Okay. Yeah, Jerry.
I understand you got an anniversary coming up. So I think we should really pray for planning for putting up with you all these years.
You're exactly right. Our anniversary is tomorrow, that's right.
Ours is Saturday.
54 years. I thought about where I could take her especially. And so we're going to McDonald's tomorrow night.
When was the last time you rescued a dog?
Day 4 years ago.
Let's know how that works out.
Bobby and Jerry's anniversary is Saturday.
Is it really? You ain't got 54 years on it.
No.
We got 23.
Okay. Well, Lord help you, 23 years. All right. Anyone else?
Remember Daisy, she was at the hospital today when she wasn't in labor.
Okay, yeah, remember her and remember Robin. Y'all don't know who Robin is, but Robin is the lady. There's a lady that worked for me for a long time, 10, 12, 15 years. Her daughter's just to have a baby. Her name's Robin. They were both work at Sunday restaurant in the kitchen there. And her name's Robin. And she went to the doctor yesterday and she was dilated to 4, I believe. So she won't be long. But remember that. Yes. Yes, remember that, both of them. All right. Anything else? Dennis says I gotta hurry.
Dennis says I gotta hurry.
All right, let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you, Lord, for who you are, what you've done for our lives. Lord, we lift up every one of these names that are mentioned here tonight. Lord, there's so many. I can't remember them all, but God, I know you know every need there. Lord, I pray that you'd meet that need, especially, God, for the lost. Lord, we lift up that soul to you. Oh, God, we pray that somehow, some way, you'd send somebody, put them in their path, Lord, that they'd be bold enough to tell them about the love of Christ and what you've done in their life. And Father, we thank you for what you're going to do, that you answer prayers. God, we expect you, God, we expect you to do that. Lord, I know you will. And Father, tonight, we do lift up all these lost. And there's so many around us, Lord. We pray for them, God, that they might come to know you before it's too late. Because we firmly believe, Lord, that that trumpet's going to sound very soon. And, Lord, we're going to get out of here. But those lost folks that are going to be left behind, oh, God, I pray that they would find you and you would find them, Lord, before it's too late. Now, God, help us tonight. As we study your word, we ask you to bless Brother David, Lord, as he teaches tonight on the prophetic end of times. And Lord, what a great deal this is, God, as we listen to this and as the story unfolds right in front of our eyes, God, we realize that this is true, Lord, and it's going to happen. A lot of people don't believe it, Lord, but it is. God, we look forward to that day, that old trumpet sounds when we get out of here. Lord, just bless tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good evening, church. Good to see all of you. Hope you've enjoyed this day. The Lord blessed us with. I know we're trying to get going here. We're turning Brother Dave loose. Look forward to seeing. He's done a great job with this, and I just look forward to seeing what he's got to say tonight. And I really don't mind. I know you need a lot of time. I don't have anything extraordinary planned tonight. I'm not going to say nothing we hadn't sung before, you know what I mean? If you want the time, I'd be more than glad to step down right now and you just go. Huh? Well, we'll do one or two and then we'll turn your lips out. All right. Let's do 10,000 reasons.
10,000 reasons for my heart to sigh. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, worship Your holy name.
That's okay. Just let it go.
Already switched it.
Count the times I called your name, some broken night. born in Jesus in a new town. Jesus when the sun goes down. Jesus in the morning, Jesus in the new town. Jesus when the sun goes down.
Amen.
Let's go to the fourth chapter. This is my text as I used last week for the raptures. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, and keep your place there because we'll be going back. I'm going to share a lot of scripture tonight, and we'll be going back there. And so just keep your place there. Let's start here at the 13th verse. Let's stand for the reading of God's word. Starting at the 13th verse. But I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren, concerning them which are asleep, that ye sorrow not, even as others which have no hope. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. For this we say unto you by the word of the Lord, that we which are alive and remain unto the coming of the Lord shall not prevent them which are asleep. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel, with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. And so what we're preaching and teaching on is simply the rapture of the church. The rapture of the church. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we come to the throne of grace. And God, is the prayer request has been mentioned tonight. I pray, God, you intervene. Those that were mentioned that were lost, I would ask for the convicting power of the Holy Spirit of God upon them. That they wouldn't sleep, they wouldn't have rest or peace. Until they accept Jesus Christ as the Lord and Savior. Amen. God, there are those upon the hearts of people here that they've got afflictions, they've got sicknesses. And so, Father, I pray for the mighty healing hand of God to touch those afflictions and sicknesses. They might look to you for the healing they need, Father. And you do the healing whichever way you desire, Heavenly Father. I know you heal instantly and divinely. But also know that many times our healing comes through surgeries or medications or treatments. And many times that's the way you choose. But I ask God for the healing for those sick and afflicted tonight. I pray, dear God, tonight, the greatest sickness throughout our nation and throughout the world is sin sickness.
Yes, yes.
And there's not but one cure. I know there are many that tell us there's many different ways to come to God. There's many different ways. But you said in John 14:6, I am the way, I am the truth, and I am the life.
Yes. Yes.
And no man cometh to the Father but by me. There's only one way. That's why you went to the cross, Lord Jesus, to die for the sins of humanity.
Yes.
And I pray tonight, this is the greatest sickness in the nation and throughout the world. I pray for every lost soul that might come to know Christ as their Savior.
Yes.
So, Father, tonight I want to present truth to these people. And I can't do that upon my own. I do not depend upon my intellect, my ability, my education. I don't depend upon the flesh. I depend entirely upon the anointing of the Holy Ghost tonight. I ask you to fill me. I ask that tonight that I would share from a heart of love and compassion, and that you would impart truth to me, that I might impart truth to these people tonight. God, move in this service. Speak to every heart here. Speak to those that watch by live stream. If there be one lost here tonight or watched by live stream, that this might be the night that you accept Christ.
Yes.
God, do a great work among us tonight.
Yes.
And help us tonight. Open our understanding for it's in Jesus' name we ask you. Amen.
Amen.
I'll briefly go over what I shared last week. We looked at those four views. concerning the rapture of the church, there is those that believe there will be no rapture. There are those that believe in the pre-trib rapture. And there are those that believe in the mid-trib rapture, which means that we will go through half of the tribulation, then the church will be raptured. There are those that believe in the post-trib rapture, of which means that at the end of the tribulation period, then the rapture takes place. I believe that it's scripturally sound to preach, and I preach and teach, that we will go in the pre-trib rapture before the seven-year tribulation period, and I give you four references of scripture of which I believe backs that up. Just briefly, one of them was concerning the events that will take place in the tribulation. There will be great supernatural things that will be taking place. There will be horror that will come upon this world such as this world has never known. And there in Luke 21, 34, 30 through 36, 25 through 26, these are the things that we are going to escape. So there's one reason why that we will not go through the tribulation period. The next one is in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 9 through 11. Verse 9 points out that we are not appointed unto wrath. So the people of God, we're not appointed unto wrath. And during the seven-year tribulation period, the wrath of God will be poured out upon a world that has rejected him, denied him, blasphemed him. The wrath of God is going to be poured out at that time, but we are not appointed unto wrath. The third thing that I showed you was over in 2 Thessalonians 2, verses 1 through 3, and then verse 8. When the rapture of the church takes place, and the saints of God will be raptured out and will be called out of this world, at that point will be when the man of sin, which is the Antichrist, at that point he will then come upon the world scene to begin to put his plan of domination upon the earth. So he will be revealed after that we are taken out. You also find that in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 and the 8th verse, as he talks about the wicked one. Now, the fourth thing that I gave you to support the pre-trib rapture was over in the 4th chapter of Revelations, the 1st verse. After that John had given the messages to the 7 churches in Asia Minor, then at that point it says, come up hither, and then I'll show you the things which must come hereafter. What does that mean? That means that the scenes that you soon see through the book of Revelation is no longer here, but seen from heaven. So that is the fourth reason I give you of why I believe in the pre-trib rapture. Ain't you thankful to God tonight? We're not going to go through the tribulation period as some think and preach and teach. Ain't you thankful tonight? All right, now, I'm going to share a lot of scripture with you. The first thing that I want us to look at tonight, here in verse 16, keep your place now here in 1 Thessalonians 4, because we'll be going back here a whole lot. The 16th verse, there's some things I want us to look at here, the 16th verse. I want us to look at the order of which things are going to take place once this great event starts, the order of which it's going to take place. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven. First of all, God will begin his descent. Many scholars believe that Christ will ascend perhaps about 6,000 feet above earth. Now, I don't find that in Scripture, but that's what many scholars believe. That he will ascend about 6,000 feet. So he will descend. What's the next thing that's going to happen? And then from heaven with a shout. So there will be a shout, and where will that come from? It will come from the voice of the archangel. So Christ will begin to ascend. The voice of the archangels will shout, and listen close. I believe every saved person, our ear will be so in tune with this shout that we as saved people, we will know that's our Lord and Savior coming back for us, and I believe we'll be in tune and know exactly what the shout is about.
Yes.
That's what I believe.
Amen.
Now, The next thing is with voice and all that, and with the trump, and with the trump of God. I believe that trump will be so distinct. It will not be a trump of retreat, but it will be a trump that will be so distinct our ears will be in tune for it. It will be a trump sound of victory, victory, victory.
That's right.
I believe we'll be in tune with it. We'll know exactly what's beginning to take place because we have faith in the Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
All right. The next thing. What will be the next thing? And the dead in Christ shall rise first. Now you notice he said the dead in Christ. If you are going to be prepared for the rapture, there's not but one way. You must be in Christ. If you are not in Christ, you are not going. I don't care how good you are. I don't care how many times you've been baptized. I don't care what good works you've done. I don't care what church you're a member of. You will not go in the rapture if you are not in Christ.
Amen.
If you're not in Christ. Now, what's going to happen? The dead will rise first. What does that mean? That means that the graveyards will begin to burst open. The dead that died in Christ will begin to rise up out of those graves to meet Christ in the air. Now listen close. This right here baffles a lot of people. They say, well, what about if a person was cremated, or what about if they burn up in fire? Now listen close. I don't care where the dead bodies are that died in Christ, they will be resurrected. I don't care where they are. Many bodies was not buried, and so therefore they just disintegrated. Or maybe they did burn up in the fire. Those bodies will be resurrected if they are in Christ. The dead in Christ shall rise first. Then what's going to happen? Then those of us that know Jesus Christ, we're going to drop this robe of flesh, and we are going to move up. We'll be raptured up along with them to meet Jesus Christ in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Amen. That's the order that it will take place. All right. The next thing that I want us to look at, look over in verse 14. For if we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so them also which sleep in Jesus will God bring with him. Two or three things I want us to look at. There is a teaching today that those that sleep in the Lord, that soul sleeps. They're sleeping in the grave. That's not right. Now listen, if they were asleep in the grave, this last part, how could God bring with him? So that is not soul sleep, and I'll get into this later. But those will come with him. Now, what we need to look at is that is not talking about soul sleep, but that is talking about that Jesus will come as our soul and spirit has went on to heaven. And I'm going to back it up with scripture here. So God will bring with him. That's not soul sleep, as many teach, because we have done gone on. Those will be those that have died in Christ, and they will come back with him to meet us. Now, I'm going to move on pretty quick, so I've got a lot to cover here. Now, when we look at that, now, the third thing I want us to look at, talking about the soul and the spirit. Let's go over to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. Just move right over to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 right there. You're right there back. Let's look at verse 23. And the very God of peace sanctify you wholly, and I pray God your whole spirit and soul and body be preserved blameless unto the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And here's what I want to say. Just as God is a Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, we are a Trinity. Now listen close. When God created man, he became a living soul. So we're a soul. Then he gave us a body to dwell in upon this earth. It is the body, the temple of God, to which it houses the Spirit of God. When you're saved, the Spirit of God comes
You have the soul of which he created, and you have the Spirit of God living within you. Now, what happens at the point of death? What happens? When you die, at that point, the body, this temple, is laid back in the grave because God said it shall return unto dust from which it is taken. So this body will be laid in the grave to go back to dust. At this moment, as soon as you pass away and take your last breath, your soul and your spirit leaves the body and it goes to heaven to be with God. And that's what he's talking about here, that he will bring them with him. It's talking about the soul and the spirit. And what's going to happen, it will be reunited with a glorified body, which I'm going to show you scripture. It will be reunited with the body, the glorified body. Okay. Now, let's go on to, let's look at 4. I'm going to back up some stuff I just told you. Go to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 6 through 9 here, I think. 2 Corinthians here.
Chapter 5, bro.
Yeah, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Let's look at starting at verse 5 here. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Let's start at verse 5. Now here's what we're doing. I'm backing up what I just told you. The soul and the spirit have gone on at the point of death. It has gone on to be with God. Your destination is sealed. The body is laid in the grave to go back to dust from which it was taken. Okay, now, I'm going to back this up with the scripture. Now, he that hath wrought us for the selfsame thing is God, who hath also given unto us the earnest of the Spirit. Therefore, we are always confident, knowing that, now listen close, knowing that whilst we are at home in the body, this is while you're alive, we are absent from the Lord. So while we're here upon earth, we're not in the physical presence of God. We're still in the body. That's what he's talking about here. Now, for we walk by faith, not by sight. We are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. Wherefore, we labor that whether present or absent, we may be accepted of him. So this is what he's talking about here. He's talking about when Christ ascends and comes back. Those that will be coming in Christ, it'll be the soul and the spirit. We will be reunited with the body. With the body. We'll have a glorified body, as I'll get into just here in a minute. So are we all up on this now? Do we understand where we're at? People are so confused. Soul sleep is a big teaching today. That's not scriptural. When you die, you don't lay in that grave, your soul and spirit. That's not scriptural. Your soul and spirit leaves the body at that time, and you go to your destination at that time. All right, now, talking about, let's look at this. Now, let's go over to 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. First Corinthians chapter 15. Now this right here, these scriptures go along with the rapture of the church. This is also concerning the rapture. Verse 15. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Neither does corruption inherit incorruption. Behold, I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. Another thing I didn't point out a while ago, but I need to. The reason that Paul used the word sleep was to simply comfort those that were concerned about friends and family that had died. He just simply used that term to help comfort those people at that time. He did not mean soul sleep. Or in him we find it again. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. For this corruptible must put on incorruption, and this mortal must put on immortality. So when this corruptible shall have put on incorruption, and this mortal shall have put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory.
Yes.
O death, where is thy sting?
Yes.
O grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. Now listen to this. But thanks be to God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as ye know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. So what's he talking about? Here again. Flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. We understand that. So therefore, we have to have a glorified body. And that's what he's talking about, that mortality should put on immortality. This will be the new body that you and I will be given to where we will put on immortality, because flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. Why? It's full of sin. It's full of corruption. It's evil.
Yeah.
And that is not going to dwell in the presence of a holy, holy
That's
God.
Right.
You know, that'd be good for us to learn that down here.
Yeah.
We need to come to a place, friends, where we start understanding the holiness of God.
Yes.
I'm telling you,
we are
getting desensitized to sin. We are starting to accept things that God calls sin.
Come on.
And we're starting to accept it.
Amen.
Now, you love people. Don't misunderstand me. You do not hate anyone. I don't care what you're involved in. God loves every single person. But the church, we are getting desensitized to sin, and we're starting to accept things within the church that we should not accept. And definitely within the government, they are cramming things down our throat that we as Christian people, we've got to square our shoulders up and say, that's wrong, it's sin, and I'm not going to accept it. We need to take a stand because God is holy, and we need to understand that. So this flesh will not inherit the kingdom of God. It's full of sin. It's full of corruption. But the glorified body will.
Yeah.
All right, now, let's move on now. Let's look at this here. All right, let's go over to 1 John chapter 3. 1 John chapter 3. Let's look at verse 2. Now here, what we're getting to here, we're getting into a glorified body. Why? Because flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God. So we've got soul, spirit. They're going to be reunited with the body. Now listen close. But it will not be this body. It will be a glorified body. Amen. Because I'm tired of these. I'm tired of wore out hips. I'm tired of a lot of things that we go through. I'm tired of a lot of things, but thank God I'm going to have a glorified body when the Jesus Christ comes and takes us home to glory. Thank you. Alright, now. Alright, look at the second verse here. Beloved now are we the sons of God. Now, at the moment that you accept Christ, you become a child of God.
Yes.
You don't have to do a bunch of good works. You don't have to be baptized. I know some of you say you do, but you don't. You do not have to do all this stuff to become a child of God. At the very moment that the Spirit of God calls you, and you get down on your knees and repent.
Yeah.
Repent.
Yeah.
Repent.
Come on.
Repent.
Yeah.
Repent. Then at that moment, you are saved, you're sealed, and you are a child of the Most High God.
Amen.
At that very moment,
Amen.
We are the sons of God.
Amen.
Okay, now, and it does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, talking about Christ, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is. Now, on the Mount of Transfiguration, they seen Christ. Moses and Elijah, Peter, James, and John was there. After Christ ascended, many seen him. Old Doubting Thomas, he had to touch him before he really come to his senses. But we shall see him. And we are going to be like Christ. Now, there's a few things I want to object to. There are some that believe, and I can't say one way or the other. There are some that believe Christ, when he died, was some 33 years old when he died. There are some that say that when we get our glorified body, this is approximately the age that we will be. I can say, I don't know, maybe. But they use that because he died at the age of 33. All I'm going to tell you is, buddy, it's going to be a whole lot better than what we've got here. So don't worry too much about that. We're going to have this glorified body. We're going to be like Christ. And praise God, we're going to be home with Christ.
Amen.
Ain't you going to be glad to get out of here?
Yeah.
All right. Glorified body. Let's go over now. We're going to back up this with one more scripture. Go over to Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3, 21. Chapter 3, 21. Philippians. Well, let's go ahead and read verse 20. Now here again, I'm backing up what I'm trying to teach to you, the glorified body. For our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. Listen close. Who shall change our vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself.
Yes.
Friends, you can't even begin to imagine what it's going to be like.
That's right.
All we know is we're living in a world of hate, wars, pain, suffering, sickness. But for those that know him, and those that have trusted him, listen, friends, God has never broken one promise.
That's right.
Amen.
And he's promised you, saints. He's promised you. He's coming back for us. Don't give up. Don't quit. Don't walk away from God. Continue to serve God. Continue to love him. But listen, when that trumpet sounds, we can't imagine. The scripture tells us this: the eye had not seen, nor the ear heard, nor had it entered into the heart of man, the things that God has prepared for them that love him. You got to be in Christ. Live streams, your goodness, your good deeds, your big banking accounts, and all the things you think is going to get you to heaven, you're going to be left behind in the trouble side. If you're sitting here in this auditorium tonight, if you are not in Christ, I'm telling you because I love you. If you are not in Christ, you are going to be left behind. And you're going to experience hell such as you cannot imagine. It's going to break loose in this world. I'm telling you because I love you. Don't walk out the door tonight if you're lost. This could be your very last opportunity. You that watch the live stream, you may laugh at the rapture. You may laugh at all that. You may say, I don't believe in God. One day you're going to believe in him. Because one day you're going to stand before him. But I'm telling you, he loves you too much. He doesn't want you to die lost. He wants you just simply to come to him and to be saved. Why? So when the trump of God sounds, you will go up to meet the Lord in the air. The other day, I took Diane to the doctor, one of her specialists, and I took her in, and when we got there, I was helping her up the stairs. She's very sick and weak. I was helping up the steps to go into the place there. There was a lady sitting over here, and you could tell by looking at her, she didn't have much in this world, you could tell. And I think she must have been sitting there waiting on a transit. She got up to go open the door for us, and she said this, almost with tears in her eyes. She said, "I've got a spot on my lung." They said, "We're going to have to do surgery." Naturally, she's concerned. I said, "Thank you." She opened the door for us, and we went in. We went in, and I got her registered, and as they come to take her back, the Spirit of God spoke to me, "You go out there to that lady and you pray for her." Friends, we need to start getting sensitive to the Spirit of God. Hear me.
That's right.
Every day of our life, there's people that are hurting. They're suffering. They're hurting. They may have a smile on their face, but they're dying inside. You never know what little action, deed, or word, and how it's going to affect them. The Spirit of God said, "You go and you pray for that lady." And I went. And I said, "Dear lady," I said, "you said you got a spot on your lung?" "Yes." I said, "Would you care if I prayed for you?" She looked up in tears and said, "No, I wouldn't pray." I laid my hand on her shoulder. And I said, "Lord God," well, first of all, she said this. She said, "I'm a Catholic." I said, "That has nothing to do with it." And I laid my hand on her. I said, "Dear God, I ask you to touch this spot on this young lady." She was an elderly woman. "And I ask your healing power to flow through her. I ask your grace and mercy upon this precious lady. And I ask your healing power to touch her. In the mighty name of Jesus, I ask you." And she was in tears. And she said, "Thank you, thank you, thank you. Lord, help us. If we don't care about the lost, who's going to care?"
That's right.
Yeah.
"If we don't encourage you, who's going to
care?"
"If we don't point to Christ, who's going to care?" Pain, suffering, sickness. But over in Revelation 21, in verse 4, this will be paraphrasing. God said there's coming a day. Not going to be any more tears. He's going to wipe the tears from our eyes. Not going to be any more pain and suffering. There's going to be a day because all the former things have passed away. When? Because when we are taken up and our home is in heaven, we've got our new bodies. We're there in the presence of Christ. And listen, friends, we won't never have to go to the funeral home. We'll never have to go to the hospital and see a loved one dying with cancer. We'll never get a phone call before there's been another tragedy. Someone just been killed tragically. Why? Because we have finally made it home. And because the former things have passed away. The rapture of the church is the next great event to take place in the calendar of God. That's no question. You can doubt it. You can say it ain't going to happen. There's no power on the face of the earth. That's going to stop the rapture of the church. No armed forces, no government, no dictator, no one is going to stop this event from taking place. It's going to happen. The question is, are you in Christ? Are you in Christ? As we stand, let's have a hymn of invitation. I present the truth to you tonight. I love you, and I present the truth to you. Now it's on your shoulder. Your blood, after this message, is not upon me. Because I've come, I've done what God told me to do, it's upon your shoulders. The decision is yours. The live stream, the decision is yours. Either come to Christ or reject him. It's up to you. You come tonight. Maybe you want to come pray for somebody. Maybe you need healing. Though somebody's lost, you want to come to this altar and pray and believe God. But the main thing, if you're lost, then you need to come tonight and get your heart right with Jesus Christ. That's the main thing here tonight. You come tonight, friend. you come and believe God. Come to me. Believe God. If you got something in your life that shouldn't be there, you don't have to come tell me. But maybe you need to come and make it right with God. What do you need tonight from God? Do you need healing? What do you need? God hears and answers prayer. Sometimes I come across strong and kind of hard. I know, but I'm not a pastor. There's a different calling between this man and me. But and I've had to go places throughout the years. I went places I didn't want to go, and I've had to preach messages that I did not want to preach. But what you got to understand, one day I've got to give an account to God. I have to give an account for what I told you here tonight, and I don't take that lightly. But even when I'm preaching hard, I try to preach with love and passion. Because when you believe it or not, I love you people. I love the lost sinner. I love people. And I know I come across strong and hard sometimes. But this is the messages that God gives me. And I have no choice. I have to be obedient to God. But I love you. This church is here to help you. This pastor is here to help you. And so anytime that we can help you, minister to you, don't hold back. Come up here. We want to minister to you. We want to help you. We want to see you get a fresh start. Now listen, Satan has plans to steal, to kill, and destroy your life.
right.
Jesus wants you to have an abundant life.
Yes.
If you'll surrender him and follow him, he will give you that abundant life.
Amen.
God bless you.
Amen.
Have a great night. Now listen, the trumpet of God can sound at any moment.
That's right.
Any moment it can take place. Now what I'm going to get into next week, we're going to start and we're going to take a look at the Antichrist, of which will be a man. We'll try to look him over starting next week. God bless you. I love you, Mick. You go ahead and do whatever you need to do.
All right. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you. God, we thank you tonight for your word.
Yes.
How it speaks to our heart.
Yes.
God, help us to know and realize that we must be in Christ to make that trip all the rapture. God, I pray for the lost tonight, especially for those that don't know you. God, every family has lost people. God, help us. Talk to them, show them that they must be born again. Bless our church. Continue to use us for your glory in all that we do. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
I told you I'd still have water.
I knew.
Well, you did. You afraid it's leaking.